Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Local Government and Communities Committee in 2017. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones and as meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting. So that's my normal appeal that if you see it on our computers, that's what we're doing. We're looking at committee papers, I promise. Apologies have been received from Elaine Smith, our Deputy Commissioner this morning, who can't make it along unfortunately. And we move to agenda item one, which is post-legislative scrutiny of the Disabled Persons Parking Places Scotland Act 2009. And the committee will take evidence from Morven Brooks, Chief Executive Officer, Scottish Disability Equality Forum, Linda Bamford, Convener, and Keith Robertson, Member, Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland, and Vycki, Ritson, Traffic Management and Road Safety, Aberdeen City Council. So thank you everyone this morning for coming along. I think we believe that the Parliament doesn't do enough post-legislative scrutiny and legislation that's passed. I should also indicate we're joined by Jackie Bailey, MSP, this morning, who took forward the piece of legislation that we're doing the post-legislative scrutiny on. So thank you very much for coming along this morning, Jackie. You're welcome. And we'll move straight to questions, if that's okay, with witnesses this morning, and Graham Simpson for the first question.
Thanks, Convener. So just a general question for all of you. How do you think the Act has worked? Do you think it's helped to reduce the misuse of disabled persons' parking spaces?
I could go first if you want. Yes, my name is Morven Brooks and I'm from Scottish Disability Equality Forum. We're a member-led organisation. We're a national organisation and we also support 40 access panels across Scotland who are groups of disabled people and volunteers. Our members genuinely believe that no, the Act it hasn't been successful, still is not successful in its implementation, especially with monitoring and enforcement. We have many anecdotal, as you'll see in the written evidence that we submitted, anecdotal evidence really outlining the fact that our members, they're not seeing the evidence of the Act being monitored fully. And again, enforcement by local authorities and Police Scotland either. Really, what many of our members are also saying as well, that there needs to be more campaigning done on the Act itself across nationally to raise awareness to the general public around the misuse of disabled parking spaces, basically.
Thank you. Anyone want to add to that? Keith Robertson.
We feel that there's been a partial effectiveness of the Act. And we took a straw poll just by phoning half a dozen councils up when we received the call for evidence. And all of them said that they had put an RTO with traffic order on most of their bays, and those that were still advisory were in the process, which is fine in its own. There's then, under the TSGRD, the Transport Signs General Roads Direction legislation, which was just being rewritten, was September, October last year. So they now comply with that. But where it does fail is in enforcement, very much enforcement. There seems to be a difference between what local authorities feel, how effective it's been, and what we experience the effect of it. Although the effect, the enforcement, the possibility of enforcement is now there, the physical enforcement for on-street parking, I'm talking only, if we get a chance to talk about off-street parking later, appreciate it, Convener, but that's how we feel on on-street parking, that it's partially been effective.
Okay, thank you. Linda Bamford.
Linda Bamford, Convener with the Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland. Just to add to both what Morven and Keith had said, that the feeling is that the Act in itself in the main is fine, but it's the enforcement issues that's creating some of the problems. Also, there is a big strand of education round about why these disabled parking places should not be abused. I'm aware that there was some campaigns run before about mental health and awareness of mental health, the kind of See Me campaigns, and there's a thought from a lot of people that this might assist, as well as the enforcement, which is key to protecting the disabled base for those that need it. I think there needs to be, and certainly people are saying that there should be, an awareness campaign just to highlight the issues of the need to keep the disabled base free for disabled people.
Okay, thank you very much, Linda Bamford. Now, Vycki, I know you don't speak on behalf of all local authorities, but you can give a snapshot of the Aberdeen experience. What's your feeling?
I would say in Aberdeen, we feel that the city centre locations and the busy locations can be enforced more vigorously than the others, the wider area. We do have a decrimson system, so we have our own city wardens and we can deploy them as we see fit. We have also, in the last couple of years, taken on a blue badge enforcement officer, and we have actually noticed within that time an improvement in the use of bays and those using them. He's been very effective at taking blue badges off of people who shouldn't be using them and are taking up those bays unnecessarily. And our warden service as well will ticket anybody without a visible blue badge when they're using these spaces. One of the issues maybe we do have is where somebody has requested a blue badge bay or disabled parking bay, and it's that space and time where the bay is not enforceable while we're progressing the TRO. So those bays can fall into disrepute, and that's probably where the majority of the dispute comes in.
I know members wish to pursue some of that. Can I just check a factual element? I was reading through some of the evidence for this morning's committee, and I saw evidence which alluded to the fact there's now no longer requirement for signage beside each individual bay. Is just checking that as the factual situation just now.
The latest TSRDD has taken that requirement away.
And I know that's clearly a cost-saving to local authorities, but I helped scrutinise that the original bill going through Parliament. And one of the discussions at the time, of course, was it's about cultural change, because you don't ever want to have to enforce, because that kind of means that there's an abuse of the system in the first place. So I know that's a cost-saving to local authorities, but do we lose something in terms of promoting a culture of responsible parking usage with no longer having the signs? I'm just wondering in relation to that. Keith, I will bring you back in, Vycki Ritson, in relation to that. Keith Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. When we looked at the TS GRD, it was felt that the poles with the signs on were not required, that there was sufficient, you know, demarcation and signage actually in the roads and the hatchings and such like. And actually, from a user's point of view, the amount of times you'd park your car and go and try to open your door and either smack your door off the pole or try to get my wheelchair, if I'm on my own, is in the passenger seat. So it comes in front of me, believe or not, it doesn't get in front of me. And you then can't get your wheelchair out because the pole's in the way, even though your doors maybe don't hit it. So you have to move your car, so you're half out of the bay or half in it, so you can get a ticket for it. And to be honest, there's more trouble north.
Well, that's very helpful. And Vycki, do you want to add? So Linda, I'll take you in first, then my apologies. Then Vycki will take you back in relation to the benefits of, because there's a feeling that maybe the legislation is starting to evolve to make it more workable and more practical. Somebody take you back in that in a second. But Linda Bamford, did you want to add something?
It was really just to add to Keith's point that with the polls, I know a lot of local authorities are also looking at the streetscapes and street clutter, and the polls being there are also a barrier for people with visual impairments and also for people that are going by in wheelchairs or indeed people with buggies and things like that. So it's beneficial for the movement of people and the flow of people if the polls aren't there.
a lot of clarity in relation to this. Vycki, do you want to add anything in terms of the positive nature of that particular change?
Yeah, I would add the same, that it is reducing street clutter, and a lot of our streets are quite narrow as well, so the removal of that sign is going to allow more space for wheelchairs and the like. One little difficulty, well, it's possibly not a difficulty, as you say, it's a cultural thing, is when our advisory spaces go in ahead of promoting a TRO behind it, we just put in the road markings. So now there's no distinction between what's an enforceable bay and what's a just an advisory bay in the interim. So we were seeking guidance from that earlier.
That's helpful. And the Grimson's got Grimson back in. I know Ruth wants to explore some of that further as well. Graham, do you want to come back in on that?
Yeah, so just on the TROs, perhaps you could explain to people what that process is and how long it takes and why you think we shouldn't have to go through it.
Okay, if we propose to put in a disabled bay, we take that proposal to committee. We'll also put an instruction out for an advisory bay to be marked on street. The committee will decide if that proposal can then go forward through the consultation process, and we will then take that through statutory consultation and public consultation. If we receive any objections to it during that time, we'll have to take it back to committee again to get a decision made on that objection, and then we can implement. Now, we have about five committee cycles a year, and we will take disabled bays to each of those committees. But the time involved with taking them to those committees and then promoting them and advertising them on street is quite resource intensive for our team.
So how long could it take? Maybe up to a year or something like that? Yeah.
Yeah, I would say 6 to 9 months.
And there's a cost involved, of course.
Yeah, it's officer time preparing those reports, going through the consultation process, reviewing all the feedback or any feedback that there is. But it's also the delay to the customer. I mean, somebody in the interim could be using that space who doesn't have a blue badge, and there's nothing we can do to enforce that as well.
You think perhaps a simplification of the Act would help so that you didn't have to promote a TRO to make it legally enforceable?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Ruth McGuire.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, panel. In STF written evidence, you highlighted concerns about local authority progress in converting advisory bays to enforceable bays. I'd just like to hear a little bit more about that, if you're satisfied that they've taken sufficient action on that front. And also, do local authorities have processes in place? We heard a little about it there, to ensure that all new bays created are enforceable and that redundant bays are removed.
Difficult to answer is because there's no consistency across Scotland and across all the local authorities. Obviously, Aberdeen Council are obviously they're making steps. They've got the processes in place. They're taking action where necessary. But you have a number of local authorities out there who are not complying with the Act as well. And because we're a national organisation, we are hearing the voices of disabled people across Scotland as a whole. So when we are hearing information that, yes, they're not being enforced in certain local authorities, it does raise, obviously, a red flag, of course, for yourselves. But it's difficult to obviously... What we are trying to say as a national organisation, there needs to be consistency in how the Act is enforced and how blue badge holders are convicted, I suppose, in a sense, going forward, or how they are treated, how that communication is taken forward, and if that makes sense. I hope
yes,
that's
it does.
Answered that.
If it's okay to add, and you don't mind just picking up what Morven was saying, of the 32 local authorities, currently six of them are in the process of applying for decriminalised parking enforcement, and nine haven't applied and have no intentions of applying in the near future. So that brings us to just under 50% of the local authorities in Scotland that don't currently have decriminalised parking enforcement powers.
Anyone else want to add to that? Keith Robertson.
There seems to be more enthusiasm, for want of a better word, for authorities that have decriminalised parking to put road traffic orders onto bees and change for advisory. And ones that haven't decriminalised, and as Linda was saying, you know, just now 18.75% of councils are in the process of applying for decriminalisation. 28.13% of councils have not, they've no intention, from what I can make out, of decriminalising. Therefore, the only way for roughly 47% of the local authorities in Scotland to enforce their parking bays is through Police Scotland. And we respect Police Scotland. I think with the resources, the competing resources that they have, enforcing parking would be pretty low down on the list. It's simply not their job. I mean, traffic wardens are done away with. You know, something has to be done to get local authorities to decriminalise parking, because without that, there is no enforcement at all. And if there's no enforcement, there's no drive to put road traffic orders on advisory bays. So it's a bit of a, for want of a cliche, postcode lottery, really, you know.
Thanks for those answers. Yeah, so the enforceable residential bays can be used by any blue badge holder. Is there a need for residential bays to be allocated to a specific blue badge holder? I'm thinking of, for examples in my own constituency with people who have trouble actually getting parked in their space that's near their house, because it can be used by anybody.
I think it's a tricky one. I spoke to a couple of my local council colleagues, and some of the applications for disabled parking bays outside residential properties are either withdrawn or not taken forward once they explain to them that it's not just for their sole use. I think it's in the fear that if that bay is marked as a disabled parking bay and there's other neighbours round about, or if it's a busier residential area, then they may not get the use of the parking bay at all, which is outside their house. So that actually works as a barrier for to the individual applying.
Anyone else got some views in relation to that? I'll take Morven Brooks and then Keith Robertson.
Really, just to support what Linda was saying there, again, we've heard from a number of members who have obviously been through the situation where they've applied for the bay themselves, but then being used by others who obviously either been misused by others who are non-blue badge holders, but also being used by blue badge holders as well. And it does seem to be a huge barrier there for disabled people who are going through that process of applying for a space in a residential area and unable to use it for themselves.
Whether that road is a trunk road and looked after by Transport Scotland, or whether it's a local authority road, it's still a public highway, and there is no mechanism to enforce a blue badge for a particular person. And I actually think that even if there was, it would put so many complications into the system. You know, there are many problems of people passing away, you know, they die, the councils haven't told that that's happened, so the bay sits for God knows how long before it's removed or you know, it's taken away. So I think if there was enforcement for individuals, which I really couldn't see, it'd be so complicated. I couldn't really see it working, to be honest. You know, it would be so complex.
Okay. Before I bring Ruth back in, anyone else want to add anything to that? Okay, Ruth,
I'm content for now, thank you.
Okay, a couple of bits for supplementaries in relation to this one. Now, just to be clear, because we want to give this in a structured fashion, it's about the balance between advisory and enforceable bays and in a residential setting as well. So I'll take Alexander Stewart and I'll bring Jackie Bailey in as well.
Thank you, Convener. We've talked about some councils that are not going to move on this at all. You've indicated a number of them are not prepared to do that. Are we also finding that in some city centre areas where that is the case, that disabled bays are being removed by the council? Because I've seen that, I've read of that, and I've had constituents contact me on that specific issue. Where people are not enforcing, then to try and get out of that situation, they're removing the bays. And have you had any information with reference to that?
I'll go. No, I haven't. In fact, I've heard the opposite. I've heard that there's been increased disabled parking bays available across all local authorities. That's one thing our members are saying. It's just how it's been enforced. That's the issue. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Reiterate what Morven just said. What we find, and I mean, I travel over Scotland, you know, whether it be Edinburgh, whether it be Perth, whether it be Aberdeen, Inverness, you know, tend to find that there's actually more bays. They're taking more cognizance of the percentage of population that have problems with mobility. And we've seen an increase in them, not the other way. I think there is, if somebody has a space taken away from them, you know, for probably very good reason, you know, but it could be a technical reason. I mean, it would be a reason for because of their physical use of it. They could be pretty aggrieved at that, you know, and that's probably why I would suggest that's probably why it's been fed through. But in general, I would say, you know, local authorities right across the board are increasing their bays. I agree with Morven and Linda said, yeah.
Thank you, Convener.
Jackie Bailey.
Yeah, I feel as if I need to be a witness rather than a questioner, Convener. Can I start by thanking the witnesses, because many of them helped to shape the bill way back in 2009. But I feel the need to start off with what the bill is not. Okay, and the bill is not about the misuse of blue badges. That came in separate legislation later. Equally, the bill is not about designating bays for particular people, because that's separate legislation that deals with that. And I think the context, if I can maybe pose this as a question to Vycki and get a conversation going, is the context is local authorities rightly said traffic regulation orders far too difficult and long a process, so we'll just create advisory bays. So what we had in Scotland was a situation where there were more advisory bays than there were enforceable bays before the legislation came in. Is that a correct understanding of the problem?
Yeah, that's my understanding.
Okay, that's helpful, because what the Act then went on to do is actually not touch traffic regulation orders, because traffic regulation orders are contained within the Road Traffic Act, which is actually reserved, which I found surprising at the time. So I couldn't change traffic regulation orders. So what the bill did was required people in the first 12 months, local authorities, to take all these advisory bays, remove the ones that were no longer used, consult people, and then make them all enforceable with one TRO. Is that the process that Aberdeen went through?
Yes, we did. I couldn't say that it happened in the first year, but it has. We have gone through it and we have audited our spaces. And we continue to do that, but it's generally on advisement from the public and through reviewing the blue badges as and when people move house or notify us that they've moved house. Or they've passed away.
Okay, so in a one-a, there was an instant difference made to the number of bays that became enforceable. That'd be fair. Okay. Can I ask you now, because I'm assuming you're a road specialist in a way that I'm not, my understanding is that Road Traffic Act has changed again in relation to bus clearways, and that there's no requirement now for a traffic regulation order. Now, that wasn't the case in 2009. It is the case now. Is that a route that local authorities would prefer to use in terms of designating future disabled parking places? Or is there a balance to be struck between a TRO which notifies neighbours and other interested parties and just giving the local authority the right to do it themselves?
We did a quick scout round the team before I came over, and apparently we've had one valid objection to a disabled bay for the installation of all the disabled bays we've had in Aberdeen. So I feel that the TRO process is not providing much feedback during that consultation process, and therefore if we could just go straight to instigation, there'd still be a feedback system for the members of the public, because they can come back and tell us that it doesn't suit for whatever reason, and we'll still monitor the situation. But yeah, we don't feel that the consultation process is actually providing much valid feedback.
Okay, so what I'm hearing, and this is my final point, convener, in this section, what I'm hearing is there is a way of making it even easier to designate disabled parking places, but what I'm hearing from the rest of the panel is actually the key issue thereafter is enforcement. So there's not a problem per se with the legislation or the process, it's a problem then with implementation and enforcement. And I wonder whether I could open that out to the rest of the panel for comment.
If I could start off on that one, certainly the information that we've been getting back from our members and those we've consulted is that the Act is fine, albeit there's an acknowledgement to the local authorities that it may be a bit onerous. But the Act in itself is fine, but it's the enforcement that needs to be more robust.
If the Parliament was going to remove the need for a road traffic order under the TSGRD, which is it's just become devolved to Parliament, I believe, the only concerning disabled people would have would be, would it still have the same enforceability as a road traffic order would have? And that would be crucial to persuade disabled people that it would still have that. Enforceability is crucial, because while the legislation in the main has done what it's meant to do for on-street parking, and I do stress very strongly on-street parking, you know, off-street parking is a totally different kettle of fish. If it's not enforced, then word quickly gets around, you know, the communities and everybody in have dog parks in it, and there's none more frustrating than driving 30 or 40 miles to go to shopping centre, can't get parked and have to drive home again because you can't get your wheelchair out.
Morven Brooks, yes.
Just really to sum up what both Lindsay and Keith have said, enforcement is the main ask here from especially our organisation and our members. Accessible parking itself is an essential part of independent living for a disabled person, and it's following up what Keith is saying there. You're driving X amount of hours to get somewhere, unable to park, it adds stress to that person's life, affects their health and wellbeing at the end of the day as well.
Thank you. Can we just rewind slightly? I want to come back and explore enforcement a little bit more. We just rewind slightly when Vycki Ritson was talking about the potential desirability of not requiring the RTO, and that would be speedier, it would be more affordable, it would be a much more smoother system. You mentioned, Vycki, that there was only one occasion where there was a valid objection received. I'm just wondering if you can tell us what a valid objection would look like, because I'm not clear, because I would have thought the disabled bay would be based on need and reasonability. So I'm just wondering what that valid objection would look like.
To be honest, I don't know exactly what that one was, but it would be if the location of the bay were inappropriate, so it may have been an officer error that resulted in the location being chosen being inappropriate for whatever reason.
Okay, and before I come back on to look at enforcement again, I'm just wondering, just thinking about not town and city centres and village main streets, now I'm thinking about in the communities, if you like, in the suburbs and in the housing schemes where disabled bays appear, is there any balance given to the percentage of parking space designated to disabled bays, because there are some streets where there's a lot of poor souls out there who have got significant mobility issues with blue badges, about the balance between enforceable disabled bays and, if you like, just general parking spaces on a road. Is any consideration given to that, Vycki Ritson?
We do have situations where that has occurred. We've got mixed residential areas, and we do try to balance the needs of all the residents. It's not always easy, and residents are not always happy with that mix. Because the disabled bays take up so much more of the available parking space, if there are a significant number of them. But we will generally audit the whole area, and obviously those without mobility issues can park that bit further away and walk if there's available parking in the area.
Sorry, apologies, Vycki, please continue.
Just say we don't have a formula, it's on a location-by-location basis.
It's maybe one to tease out in the future, because if there's no consultations and objections processes with RTOs, it might be worth teasing out in the future about what that balance might look like. Because if we make this work, there could be lots, quite rightly, lots more disabled bays. If we get the enforcement right, a process around that, it might be important to just get what the criteria is for balance as well. But I just wanted to explore some of that. But Vycki, you also mentioned that Aberdeen had taken the step of appointing an enforcement officer. Now, I wonder if you could just say a little bit more about how that works. That would be quite helpful.
Well, the enforcement of the bays themselves are carried out by the city wardens. But we do have an additional officer who's a blue badge enforcement officer. So he will be looking into areas where people are parked with blue badges, but their blue badges are out of date or copied or being used inappropriately. So he's just trying to ensure that those using the blue badge spaces are the appropriate people.
And is there a process if someone, not someone inappropriately using a blue badge now, if someone without a blue badge parked in an enforceable bay and one of Aberdeen's wardens identifies that, or the enforcement officer identifies that, what's the process that happens at that stage?
They'll be issued with a penalty charge notice. And
how much is that?
It's £60, but it's reduced to £30 if it's paid within a short period.
Okay, I'm just wondering about, obviously there's financial implications for local authorities, but without naming individual local authorities, if you speak to constituents, they sometimes think local authorities, not Aberdeen, are quite good at chasing a fine system to maximise income. And this might actually be, some of my constituents might not like it, but this certainly appears as if it could be an opportunity in relation to that. Anyone get any comments in relation to how enforcement doesn't necessarily have to be a costly basis, but could be in everyone's interest? How do we improve enforcement, I suppose, is the question I'm asking.
I think one of our members suggested an enforcement hotline number. Again, that could reduce cost with staffing resources in that sense. You've got one main hotline number that you can obviously report to if someone's parked in, a non-blue badge holder's parked in a designated parking disabled bay. Cost-wise, it is difficult, but I personally feel, and probably our members probably feel as well, that obviously a penalty is the way to go. But whether that obviously does make a difference to people's attitudes, it's attitudes at the end of the day that's causing the issue. People not understanding and appreciating the needs of a disabled parking space, and that education needs to be increased, as well as obviously enforcing a penalty to ensure that they understand that there is a penalty to parking in these spaces.
Yeah, certainly in my experience, there's nothing like a fine or points on your licence to focus the mind for awareness raising in relation to breaching a parking offence. So have we got the balance right in relation to what the consequences are in terms of fines or whatever, in terms of enforcement? Keith Robertson.
No, Convener, I don't believe we do. I believe if people were actually fined more, they're less likely to do it again, basically. I do think that local authorities, while they may not ever quite reach a financial level playing field, if you want, that the service isn't actually paying for itself through fines. I think for the future, there's a possibility of that, especially if they go down the roads to maybe using collaboration, the same as we're starting to do in roads maintenance, where authorities are getting together to look at enforcement instead of this piecemeal we've got, where every local authority's got a different scheme, a different method of enforcing, or enforcement. I don't know why, you know, probably because it's rather a new concept, actually, that there's not more collaboration between local authorities to join up and say, right, let's look at, you know, enforcing our traffic or parking together, you know, and running one scheme between three or four or more local authorities. It would make sense to do that. One thing I think might interest you, when I parked out in the front today, I don't have any app on my phone for Edinburgh parking, but I got a message on my phone that said, Edinburgh City Parking, please show that you're authorised to park in the disabled bay you're in. And I thought, because I was phoning London to see which it was, or I wouldn't have seen it, it didn't make a noise, which was a pity. But that came up on my phone, I thought, that's smart. That really is smart ticketing at its best. Don't even have an app, and yet it came up on my phone to say, remember, put your blue badge on your, basically on your windscreen. I thought that was very good.
Yeah, so I mean, I take it the point you're absolutely making about more clever use of technology, better working between local authorities, but even within a local authority where you've got, you know, dog wardens, litter, graffiti, parking, there's a whole range of things local authority staff are seeking to deal with infringements and enforcement on. Now, before we move on to the next line of questioning, just any other suggestions in terms of enforcement that you might want to put on the public record, then we'll move on to our next line of questioning. Morven Brooks.
A member-led organisation, I mentioned earlier, we also work with 40 access panels across Scotland. We support them. We don't govern them, but we support them. But we've been working for a number of years to try and get the access panels to become statutory consultee status. So they are fully recognised within the local authorities to be consulted with, basically. Currently, many of the access panels have got good relationships with the planning departments, i.e. looking at accessibility of general accessibility in communities. But this would be a good area to get access panels involved. These are groups of volunteers with various disabilities. Their lived experience would be vital to provide that consultation, support, knowledge, evidence to local authorities to help progress issues like this, basically.
I think it would also be very good for public support, because rather than just the council looking for other gimmick to get money from you, if that access panel is actually suggesting some of these enforcement strategies, you get more consensus in relation
Absolutely.
To it. Yeah. Just before we move on, anyone else want to suggest? Linda Bamford?
It was just to come in on the back of that, just to say that with the enforcement, people may not be aware of the consequences if they don't have a disability of using a disabled place, but they are knowingly using it, because you can't miss them with the signage that's there, so they are knowingly using it, but maybe just not aware of the consequences, and hence it takes me back to the kind of education and awareness campaign on around the use for disabled spaces. And I think the other thing is to tie that into the fact of making it become more morally and socially unacceptable to do so.
Okay, thank you. Now, that was very helpful. I'm going to move on now. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for coming this morning. I just want to talk about the private car parks or off-street parking, which Keith mentioned. It would be helpful for the committee, perhaps, if you just outline the situation that existed before the Act came into force and what the Act was attempting to do in relation to off-street parking.
Oh, sorry, Keith Robertson, my apologies.
Thank you, Convener. Before that came into force, off-street parking, i.e. private parking bays, was a mix of how they were signed out, you know, how they were drawn on the tarmac or the surface. There was no signs up saying they get enforcement, there was any enforcement, there was no enforcement, and actually there still isn't. There still is no enforcement. You may see a sign in a supermarket saying, you'll get fined £100 if you say that. I've never, ever seen an enforcement officer in a private car park, ever. And I've been in a wheelchair nearly 40 years. I think these signs are put up, I may be wrong, but I think these signs are put up as a tick box exercise. There is no consistency in private car parks. When I phoned some of the local authorities to get a sort of straw poll, I asked them why they thought, just anecdotally, this was the case. And they gave two main reasons. One was that private car park owners, whether that be supermarkets, actual car parks, didn't want to spend money on putting proper markings in place. And secondly, they didn't want to fine the majority of their customers. And I've had personal experience of that, where a supermarket went in and said, look, out of X amount of bays you've got, nearly half of them had no blue badges, could you do something about it? And they said, no. I said, well, why? You know, they said, because we look after customers. I said, I'm a customer. I said, yeah, but you're in the minority. That's not unusual. That is not unusual. Saturday, I went in the usual supermarket's car park. There were 14 bays, six had no blue badges on them, you know. And the people that were coming out, more obviously, were not disabled or had a mobility problem of any kind, you know. It's not enforced. It's a huge problem. And unless, I honestly believe, unless legislation is put in place, it's not going to happen. You know?
So the legislation, just to be clear, provides that local authorities should enter into negotiations around making them enforceable. So some of the evidence we've got from Edinburgh City Council, for example, suggests that they sent 19,000 letters to non-domestic rape properties, 5,300 responses, and only 32 indicated desire for enforcement. What is the kind of scale of transfer from, or what's what was the kind of scale of places that are being, that private operators are agreeing to have enforceable across Scotland?
Thank you. Take you back in this, wondering, because others might have a view in relation to private spaces and how the use or abuse of the enforcement or lack of it there. I promise you I'll take you back in. Keith Robertson, anyone else want to add? Morven Brooks, do you want to add?
I can't answer you around, I don't have any figures around what the scale of what the issue is, but the majority of our members are telling us that the biggest problem that they have with disabled parking is within private off-street parking, especially supermarkets. Health centres particularly is a huge issue. There's no enforcement there. Of course, it's what we're hearing as well. As an organisation, we go out and deliver information and advice to employers quite widely. We're going to be going down the training direction soon. And this is what I'm coming to, is the employers feel uncomfortable challenging it with disabled people or non-disabled people, in the terms of they don't want to lose people's business, quite rightly what Keith said. But there is an issue there that what needs to be tackled is education and awareness and disability equality and awareness. And really, there's organisations like ourselves that can tackle that, but there is a wider campaign required across Scotland, across accessibility in general, but homing in particular issues with accessible parking, for example, to accessible housing. So there is a wide cultural attitude change needing to happen, but the biggest issue that our members are saying is when it comes to private parking, they know that it's not enforceable. You and I, who are probably not disabled, we know it's not enforceable, so of course people abuse it.
Okay, thank you. Linda Bamford.
I was just picking up again and one of the issues that were raised about the local authorities engaging with the people providing private off-street parking. And I know like almost 20,000 letters is a lot to put out just to get about 30 returns. But of interest, from what I've seen when I looked at that, there wasn't one follow-up to the returns. If the letters had been with the right intent, then the follow-up would have actioned in the hope that changing the system in some of the 32 off-street private car parks may have had others to follow. And in my mind, not following it up showed the letters maybe to be a tick-box exercise. And picking up on Morven's point about health centres, there seems to be a really big issue in health centres for disabled parking. And there's hidden costs to that as well. I spoke to a few people about this, and some of them had actually hadn't attended the GP appointment because they couldn't get parked and had to go away again. So the hidden costs are to the health service with the misused GP appointments.
Okay, thank you. Vycki Ritson, can I just maybe bring you in at this point? I'm just wondering, again, poor Aberdeen, thank you for giving evidence and thank you for coming along, but it's the kind of Aberdeen show a little bit today in relation to local authorities. Would Aberdeen City Council, would they enter into discussions with large supermarket chains that have got car parks there? I mean, here's just one to pluck from thin air. If a private supermarket said, we'll give you a few thousand pounds a year, could you just add this to your public space for enforcement? It would help fund your enforcement officers and wardens, and they could forget about that conflict between whether it's their customers or not, because they could just blame it on the council if they wanted. Is there not a much more sensible way of doing this?
Yeah, I mean, certainly when the changes were made, we did approach all the private car parks and didn't get a high response or any response, and certainly no processes were taken forward from that. We do engage with upcoming developments, so, you know, projects that are new, where changes are being made, and try to get them to take on these as well. But yeah, again, there's not much take up on that. If they were to come to us, that would be great. If they were to offer money to assist with the enforcement costs, that would be thoroughly acceptable. I don't think stepping out of line by saying that.
We may have to compel them, of course, Mr. Ritson, but, you know, this place does make laws, so that's just a thought. Andy, I might want to follow up on some of that.
That's interesting. So the off-street parking is a catch-all. I mean, it's everything that's not on a public highway, so it includes things like health centres. And it does concern me that public facilities paid for by the public purse, particularly things like health centres and hospitals, that we've got a particular problem there. And it also strikes me that it's a bit bizarre that we have to go down the route of making these parking bays enforceable under traffic regulations for there to be a guarantee that people with disabilities can get access to a place to park their vehicle. Is my surprise shared by yourselves? I mean, it's one thing to have expectations of what a law firm might do with its car park that's available to customers, or a small, you know, furniture retailer or something. But for health centres, it seems a bit bizarre.
I was waiting to Keith to put up his hand there because I said I would let him back in earlier and I didn't, so my apologies. Was it Keith Robertson and then Linda Bamford?
The last question first. There was a specific layout laid down within the traffic signs and general road direction legislation of how a disabled bay should be laid out. That's there for a reason. You go into private bays, some of them aren't wide enough, some have no hatchings at the side, some have no hatchings at the back, which for rear access vehicles is essential. Some of them aren't long enough. You know, it's just a mishmash. So they have to have a particular layout, and that layout is then enforceable. I think without having that particular layout, it's not going to work, you know, unless you start to have mobility bees and disabled bees and bring a mismatch, which I would suggest happens. Disabled bee should be a disabled bee. Following on to what you're saying, just previously, convener, Linda was saying, I think local authorities out there have tried their best with private car park owners to get them to enforce their car parks through the local authority. But all they need to say is, no, not interested. And that's it, gone. You know, if the figure isn't zero, I would suggest, anecdotally, it's very, very close to zero. And even if there was a good, decent uptake to it, half the local authorities in Scotland couldn't enforce it because they've not decriminalised the parking. So only a touch over 50% could have enforced it anyway. So unless every local authority decriminalised the parking, it's a waste of time. You know, for those that haven't, there has to be a consistency here as well as an education programme.
Is Linda Bamford?
I think Keith picked up in most of my points, but just for clarity, some of the NHS buildings, like some of the larger hospitals, do have private operators that enforce parking, but this is parking overall as well as the disabled base. But in the main, most health centres don't have enforceable parking, and therefore they're more liable to abuse of the disabled spaces.
Okay. Can I just check whether any other witnesses want to add to that before you come back in, Andy?
Agree with Linda.
Yeah. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, Andy, right.
So it'd be fair to say, I mean, in Edinburgh's case, as an example, they say, you know, of these 32 businesses, they were advised that they were responsible for meeting the standards Mr. Robertson outlined before a TRO can be progressed. And since 2009, not one traffic regulation order has been progressed, etc. So that may not be typical of the whole of Scotland, but would it be fair to say that the 2009 Act has made very little difference to the provision of disabled parking and off-street parking.
Yeah. Do you want to answer
just
that?
What I've said before, the majority of our members don't agree. They agree that it hasn't been successful. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Now, I know a couple of supplementaries in off-street parking. Graham Simpson, followed by Jackie Bailey.
Yeah, so just to be absolutely clear in my head, on off-street parking, let's take a multi-storey car park. Owned by a private operator, they may have, say, half a dozen disabled bays marked out. Is there anything legally that they can do if they chose to enforce those bays without involving a council?
Linda Bamford. You'd allowed not to be sure, incidentally.
Yeah, no, I was just going to add that, to my knowledge, places that do have private enforcement companies will fine, but they'll fine for parking and out with the time within your ticket, or parking in a disabled bay without a blue badge. So there'll be fines or penalty charge notices across the board where they do have a private enforcement provider with a service level agreement with them for that purpose. But in other places that have private off-street parking that don't have an agreement with a private company for their enforcement, then no, they're not enforced at all.
But of course, the private company doesn't make it enforceable. It just means they get a private company to pursue the person. So I'm just wondering around if people are not sure that that's fine, just around enforcement, Keith Robertson.
I think there's something that we mustn't get mixed up with here. A private car parking company doesn't recognise a blue badge, so you don't get free parking. You know, it's the same expense as anybody else. And given only 42% of disabled people in Scotland actually are employment, most can't afford to park in these very expensive car parks. So while they may be laid out properly, that the cost mean they can't park there. We mustn't get that mixed up with the like of supermarket car parks, health centre car parks, who would recognise the blue badge and there would not be a charge, you know, but they don't enforce it. There's a difference between the two. The private car parking company, they're enforcing it, pure and simple, because if you don't pay it, you can't get out the barrier. They'll not let you out. So there's a difference there.
determined what form.
That's a really interesting distinction, because the situation I described, of course, in most cases, you would have to go through a barrier, get a ticket, and then pay to get out. I used to use a multi-storey car park in Glasgow. I won't name the company. It was a major parking company. The disabled bays were routinely ignored by able-bodied people, and nobody ever got ticketed. It just struck me as a ridiculous situation, but you've described it perfectly. Do you think that's something we should tackle?
Yeah.
Okay. And how?
Keith Robertson nodding his head. The difficult bit is how we tackle it, of course. I can see Jackie Bailey,
Coraline,
really keen, I suspect, to ask a question, but also perhaps suggest. I can, just for the record, Jackie, at some point we will have you there as a witness as well.
Absolutely, that would be great.
I promise. So perhaps with the permission of Graham Simpson, should we all, Jackie Bailey, to ask a question? What do you think?
I think that would be appropriate.
Okay, Miss Bailey.
It's amazing how much you remember from back in 2009. Our principal problem, I think, and maybe I'll try and pose this as a conversation with Vycki if she doesn't mind. At the point the legislation came in, was it not the case that actually we couldn't legislate in respect of private car parks and off-street parking, particularly if it was owned by a business?
I'd have to be honest and say I'm not entirely sure.
Okay.
I would suspect that, yes, that is the case.
Yeah, that was indeed the case, which is why the legislation is framed in the way it is. It did, if my memory is correct, a number of things. So firstly, it asked local authorities to identify all the off-street car parking in private car parks at the date of the Act. Then where it was council owned or managed, the council was to promote a TRO to make them enforceable. And the third bit, which is where we couldn't really legislate, was to get local authorities to encourage private sector companies to do the right thing. Would that be a fair interpretation?
Yes.
Okay, that's great. That was helpful to lay out.
Well, that may be called leading the witness, of course, Ms. Bailey, but that's very helpful to the
committee. Asking very closed questions in order to facilitate everybody's understanding. So the intention of the bill was in relation to private car parks, but only where the public had access. So those car parks, office buildings, etc., were covered by the Disability Discrimination Act. You know, and I would turn to Morven as well for confirmation that that's a correct understanding too.
Yes.
Excellent. That's good. Okay. To the meat of this, you're absolutely right. This was the weakness, if you like, because all we could do was encourage. But I would ask for your view, because my recollection at the time was there were some supermarkets falling over each other to compete for that customer base, so we're putting in disabled car parking, we're getting private companies to enforce it, and I typically remember Asda, who to this day still do in my local area the enforcement activity, and then they take the money they generate and put it into grant-making activities and do so in a great blaze of publicity. And they surveyed their customers. And the interesting thing about them, because it's all about the business case, they understood that it wasn't just disabled people that thought it was a good idea. The entirety of their customer base, by a huge percentage, thought that this was a great idea. Is that the kind of thing that you think can be encouraged in the future? And certainly the bill did some of that, but it's how we encourage more of it, and that's less about legislation and more about understanding their customers. I think that was kind of a question.
I suppose I could kind of confirm I have a large supermarket in my constituency which does the same thing. They're very keen to get me to go and get my picture taken beside what they do. That may or may not have been Asda, of course, Ms. Bailey. But that was kind of a question which Morven Brooks is going to answer.
Again, it's coming down to consistency across Scotland, though, isn't it? You've got really good supermarkets operating in that manner, bigger supermarkets in bigger cities doing the right thing and correctly. But then I live in Alloa, and I've never witnessed our local supermarkets ever enforcing any parking bays. One comment I was going to make, though, with our social media activity, what comes up quite a lot is people posting up pictures of somebody
illegally, you can't really call it illegally, can you? But parking in a disabled parking bay without a blue badge, they're posting it up on Facebook, you get screens and screens of obviously comments on it. But then what's not being picked up on either is hidden disabilities is a huge issue as well. You don't necessarily have to be a wheelchair user to be using these parking bays. So there needs to be an approach. So these good supermarkets, for example, who are we should follow by example, basically, they need to spread that message, encourage, really that chain needs to encourage all their supermarkets to do the same. I'm an Aldi shopper personally, but and again, it's awful. But it's just awful. Every time I go there, I actually just want to know. You see the workmen sitting in their vans, and I'm one of these annoying people. Have you got your blue badge? So, yeah, but that's just because obviously I'm more aware of it. I know what's right, what's wrong in my book. And it comes down to attitudes and awareness as well.
Can we explore that further? Jackie Bailey's rightly talk about encouraging, but that language is used carefully because it's about what there's the power to dictate and what there's not the power to dictate. So I know it's a big ask, but if we put to the side where the power sits to dictate in legislation, would it be reasonable to suggest that any private car park, be it a supermarket or whatever, that doesn't have a verifiable approved enforcement system for disabled bays should have to be part of the local authority strategy and any expense around that, but it should be enforceable? And if that requires a law change, that just requires a law change. Because it seems crazy that we have to rely on the goodwill of large multinational companies that are making millions of pounds, including off of disabled people. So if there has to be a law change, should we just work out how to do it? Mr. Robertson.
I would agree, Convener. I also think it would assist local authorities in their own enforcement schemes to become more cost-effective if private companies were buying into them, buying into the local authority enforcement. I also think the public would have more confidence in that enforcement. You know, I know of one supermarket that before the legislation came in place, policed their bays, and a certain percentage of the proceeds were put to charity. After the legislation came in place, they scrapped it. But it also leaves users open to what can only be described as hate crime. And I've faced that before. It was, instance, a man with 4x4 parked with a boat behind it, blocking 4 or 5 bays off. I put my head out the window and said, "Excuse me, pal, could you move it? Because I need to park in there." And he was wanting to drag me out of the car and beat me up. And I got my wife to put my wheelchair out, and he saw that and went, "Oh," sort of thing, you know. But sometimes the abuse that you take of people who are parked where they shouldn't be is nothing short than hate crime. It can be quite frightening, actually, at times, you know. And I'm not 4'8", although I look it, I'm actually 6 foot tall. But if somebody's looking down on you, it's still quite frightening, you know.
Well, it doesn't matter what size you are, no one should be in fear and harassment, but thank you for putting that on the record. Internally, we're not designing what a law change would look like or how or whether it's achievable or not, but is it desirable, Linda Bamford?
It was just to say that the system that you described would be desirable, but I think on the back of that, the system that Ms Bailey described when she was talking about that bit, it's not about the penalty charge notices and generating income, it's about reinvesting in the community with the grant schemes and then making awareness into that. That link back into reinvesting in the local community, I think, would be very important for all the people using that supermarket or that car park in the community.
I do recall a large retailer levy that the Scottish Government brought in for retailers above a certain square footage selling alcohol and tobacco was quite controversial at the time, but that raised cash. There's always procedures by which governments can look at incentivising the private sector to do the right thing. So just any additional comments in relation to law changes or what have you, Morven Brooks?
I think what you've put across, it does make sense to go down that route with private landowners, for example, private car park owners, being more accountable to the local authorities for the parking spaces there. I think what, at the moment, again, is an attitude there for private owners to just not take responsibility whatsoever. And again, that riles people up and causes confusion about what's right and what's wrong.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm looking at my fellow MSPs. Any additional questions at this stage? Alexander, yes.
We touched on at the very beginning, you talked about a campaign, a sort of public awareness campaign. Now, what Mr. Robertson just talked about, the aggression that someone's, all of that, what would you suggest that should be put in place to try and manage that campaign so that we get the message out to the public about disabled parking and the abuse that takes place across the piece?
I think you need to go down the route of, you've had mental health campaigns, you've had hate crime, I think there's hate crime campaigns out there as well. You do need to have a hard-hitting campaign, visual, plain English out there, simple for people to understand, but really getting really hard-hitting in the sense that this, people using disabled parking spaces when they shouldn't be, really does affect disabled people's lives, and that's what needs to be targeted. Yes, there are cost implications there, there's resource implications there for local authorities and private car park owners there, but the hard-hitting campaign that to raise awareness and change people's attitudes generally towards disabled people and their needs, it really needs to focus on, do you know, they're the same as us, but we have a right a wheelchair user has a right to a disabled parking space so he can go to his local health centre or do his weekly shopping. But also raising the awareness of hidden disabilities as well is important, not just targeting that wheelchair users. It has to be disabilities across the board.
Keith Robertson, just before I let you in, we just be drawing towards the close of the session. I'll give everyone an opportunity to come back in at this stage. The committee is looking at what further scrutiny we're going to do in relation to this particular piece of legislation. So any suggestions you might have in how we take this forward, we'll of course decide how we want to take that forward, but this is your opportunity to say what you might like us to focus on or what you might like us to do. Mr. Robertson.
Thank you, Convener. The resource implications, especially for supermarkets and such like, yeah, there is to the people who own these supermarkets, but I spend my money in a supermarket like anybody else. Surely I've got the right to the same credibility as anyone else. If there was going to be an education programme or publicity programme, I think for me it would be in two parts. One part would be bottom up, for informing members of the public what was right, what was wrong, and what was decent and what is not decent to do. You know? And the other side of it, I think, is informing and educating the businesses themselves. And that, I think, would be a top-down exercise. I think you start with the management, because that's who makes the decisions. They've got to understand first that what they're doing is wrong, and then get that fed down to their workforce. So I think that there's two parts to it. Public, bottom up, actual owners of the car park, supermarkets, whatever, top down.
Thank you very much. Anyone else want to put something on the record before we close this particular evidence session? Morven Brooks.
Really just what I said earlier, a consistent approach to enforcement across all local authorities. There is good work being done currently, you can see that, but there is more to be done, but the general consensus from our members, not enough is being done. So more consistent approach to enforcement. And a national awareness and education campaign, most definitely. The culture of our society does need to take and really be aware of disabled people's needs.
Okay, thank you. Linda Bamford.
Yeah, and it was just to I know we spoke quite a bit today about the enforcement of the disabled bays and the decriminalisation of the parking enforcement for local authorities, but just remembering is that the ultimate objective of that was that we had 100% compliance with restriction with no penalty notices. So the enforcement of disabled bays isn't about generating income, it isn't about putting out penalty notices for inappropriate parking, it's about getting 100% compliance with the Road Traffic Act.
Okay, thank you. Vycki, do you want to add anything before we close the evidence session?
I think I would support those statements that have been made. Would ask again for the process to be looked at to see if we can reduce the resource implications for councils in just getting those bays out there in the first place. And I think that might help in negotiations with private car parks as well.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, can I thank all our witnesses this morning? It's been very, very helpful. We will be returning to this issue. Also, thank you, Jackie Bailey, for coming along and joining the committee this morning. We look forward to hearing from yourself in the future as well when we consider this matter further. So thank you. That ends agenda item one. We'll suspend briefly just to allow the witnesses to head off. Thank you. Okay, welcome back, and we now move to agenda item two, which is a public petition. The committee will consider public petition PE1539 in the name of Anne Booth. It calls on the Scottish Government to make an order under Section 5 of the Freedom of Information Act Scotland 2002 to make all housing associations subject to the provisions of the Act. At this point, I should declare interest. Anne Booth is indeed a constituent of mine, and I know Sean Clerkin, who's associated with the petition as well, and I welcome both of them to the public gallery today, although at this point in the proceedings, unfortunately, they're not allowed to make a contribution, but we welcome you here. This petition was previously considered by the Session 4 Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, who agreed to keep the petition open until the Scottish Government had consulted on whether registered social landlords should be covered by Freedom of Information. Given that this was not due to happen until the following session, the petition was handed over for this committee to deal with. The committee agreed during its business planning session that it would consider the petition following the close of the Scottish Government's consultation. That consultation is now closed and received 71 responses, which have been published. It is less clear, however, when the Scottish Government will be in a position to provide a formal response. At this stage, can I invite any comments that committee members may wish to make? Okay. Oh, yes, Andy Wyman.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, this petition has been running now for 2.5 years. It's an important petition. It calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to bring RSLs within the Freedom of Information regime. My view is as much urging as has been possible has been done. The Scottish Government is consulted on the matter. It's considering the consultation responses and it's considering its next steps. We don't have the power to introduce this order. Government ministers would have to do it. My view is that we have urged as much as it is possible to urge and therefore it might be advisable to close the petition.
Okay, any other comments at this stage? Okay, well, we do have some options, Mr. Whiteman. I'll run through them just now. So I would invite the committee members to consider whether you wish to take any action in relation to this petition. Mr. Whiteman has obviously suggested what one of those actions could be. We could wait, and of course we could close the petition. We could wait until the Scottish Government provides a formal response before considering our next steps, or we could write to the Scottish Government for an update and an indicative timescale in relation to the outcome of its consultation and update the petitioners in due course. With the committee's agreement, I'd like to give my views in relation to what our options are. I think at some point we clearly do have to close this petition, although I think the appropriate time to close it would be when the Scottish Government has made its final decision on whether to introduce legislation or not. And I think it's reasonable for this committee to seek certainty over a timescale, as well as the petitioners to get some certainty over a timescale. So noting the fact that we are moving towards this petition eventually being formally closed, I would suggest to committee members, if there's an agreement, at this stage, we keep it open, but just for the time being, and we write to the Scottish Government for an update and indicative timescale in relation to the outcome of its consultation, and as I previously update the Commissioner, I don't know if, the petitioner, I don't know if that would be agreeable to the committee or not. Alexander?
Convener, can I just indicate, I would be happy to support that. I think it's important that we give due clarity to the ourselves here on committee and also to the individuals who put forward the petition. And I think to write and ask for some more clarity as to our timescale would be very appropriate. And after we get that, we will then work towards the closing down of the process.
Any other comments in relation to that?
Alexander has actually said, I think that seems a fair and reasonable way forward, Convener.
Okay, thank you. There is, of course, a wider issue about petitions that stay open for a number of years, giving certainty and finality to petitioners, and we're very aware of that. It's also worth noting that when the petition is eventually closed, the Scottish Government, should it bring forward its legislation, will be by affirmative instrument, and at that point, the petitioners and others can give written evidence to our committee when we would look at that again. So, just to confirm then, we will write to the Scottish Government for an update and indicative timescale in relation to the outcome of its consultation and update the petitioner. Are we agreed to that approach? Thank you very much. We now move to agenda item 3, subordinate legislation. The committee will consider 4 negative instruments as listed in the agenda, SSIs 2017/61, 2017/64, 2017/66 and /85. These instruments are laid under the negative procedure, which means that their provision will come into force unless the Parliament votes on a motion to annul the instruments. The last instrument, 2017-85, in relation to non-domestic rates, has not been laid within 28 days of it coming into force. It will come into force on the 1st of April. A letter from the Scottish Government to the presiding officer explaining the reasons for the delay is included in the papers. I wonder if at this point it would be useful to actually comment in relation to the Subordinate Legislation Committee that drew this to our attention. It said, the committee finds the failure to comply with Section 28 to be acceptable in the circumstances as outlined in the letter from the Local Government and Analytical Services Division in the Scottish Government to the presiding officer dated 16 March 2017, supplemented by a written response to the committee on the regulations. I thought it was helpful to put that on the record at this stage. I should note that no motion to null has been laid. Can I invite members for any comments they may wish to make on the instruments? Okay, no member has indicated that they wish to speak, suggesting that perhaps no member has any significant comments or concerns. Can I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any recommendations in relation to these instruments? Are we agreed? Okay, thank you for that. And we do now move to private session, which is agenda item 4. Thank you. Close.